Welcome back to Eye School with me, Dr. D, where I teach you about products and treatments related to dry eye syndrome and eye beauty so that you can have healthy, beautiful, comfortable eyes. Give a little love tap on that subscribe button down below to stay up to date with all the latest eye tips and tricks I have for you. Preservatives are a necessary component in both makeup and skincare. Without them, dangerous bacteria can grow within your products. But when your eyes and eyelids are dry and sensitive, it is often those same preservatives that cause irritation. And that's why it's important to flip over those labels and examine the preservatives in your makeup and your skincare. I've compiled this guide to help you make sense of the ingredients that could be harming your eyes. Phenoxyethanol. Often vilified, the truth about phenoxyethanol is a little more complex. When combined with the right synergistic ingredients and at low concentrations, it can actually be okay for the ocular surface. Formaldehyde donors. This is one category you'll definitely want to avoid. Like BAK, formaldehyde donors can kill corneal, meibomian, and conjunctival cells. Parabens. Also given a bad name, in very small doses, they don't kill meibomian gland cells. Think more parabens listed, the worse it is? That's actually false. With more parabens listed, they're typically using lower concentrations of each one, which seems to be better for ocular surface health. Retinol. Retinol has a detrimental effect on the meibomian glands, but at the same time is great for the corneal cells where dryness manifests. Therefore, I encourage caution with retinol under the care of an eye care professional who can image your meibomian glands and monitor for changes. Tea tree oil. Despite a recent study showing it can be toxic to meibomian gland cells, at low concentrations, it does seem to be okay. Doctors are still using it extensively and it is still on the shelves at most stores. If you have a Demodex overpopulation, tea tree oil is still the standard of care. Carbon black. Definitely not good if you inhale it, but carbon black may not be as bad topically as you might think. This is an example of an ingredient that has definitive research in one area saying it causes toxic effects, like if you inhale it in your lungs, but topically in a cosmetic preparation, we don't necessarily see that same effect. Argireline, Botox in a jar. Argireline is a cult favorite. But my concern around decreasing the orbicularis strength with argireline is that it could lead to incomplete blinking. Incomplete blinking leads to meibomian glands that are not emptied well, which could lead to dry eye symptoms. Bakuchiol, touted as a more natural alternative to retinol. Bakuchiol doesn't yet have any eye studies for us to reference, which means be cautious and I'll tell you what I find out. Isopropyl cloprostenate. Isopropyl cloprostenate is a prostaglandin, and prostaglandins are known to negatively impact important glands for tear production, the meibomian glands. Commonly, these are found in lash serum, so avoid anything with a prost ending. Ingredient toxicity is often very complicated and nuanced. As you can see from this guide, the preparation of the cosmetic or cosmeceutical matters. Where it's applied and the concentration matters as well. It isn't so simple as vilifying independent ingredients in all cases. And especially in the case of patients with sensitive eyes, it's important to remember that your particular hypersensitivities may be isolated to you. This guide is meant to familiarize you with what you should be evaluating and looking for, but individual recommendations should always be done by your eye doctor or your dermatologist. And if you have made it this far and you're not already subscribed to my channel, please hit that button and the bell so that you don't miss notifications. That's it for today's Eye School. Class is dismissed.